Hello everyone, my name is Nicolas Revert. I'm a rescue archaeologist in Metz, northeastern France, and today we are going to talk about architectonic blocks which have been turned on the lathe. This paper will focus on the experimental reconstruction and use of a vertical lathe based on traces on the archaeological artifacts which are being studied in a budding project on northeastern Gaul. But what do I mean by turning stones? Since the 1980s, researchers identified many artifacts around the Mediterranean that display marks of stone turning. These are concentric grooves or ridges and numerous thin and perfectly executed moldings. This can only be achieved through either an exceptionally lengthy workmanship or, more compellingly, through a turning process. Recent studies have also underlined the importance of relatively wide mortises in one or both extremities of the blocks to insert a wooden or metal axis, allowing the stone to turn on the lathe. In terms of chronology, the first known examples of architectonic stone turning date back to the Greek Archaic period in the Herbarium of Samos. This technology was already widespread during the Roman imperial period, possibly in the whole empire. No data currently supports its survival in Western Europe until the late Middle Ages, when it reappears in small columns. A diverse and abundant production of stone-turned artifacts seems to emanate from northeastern Gaul, especially in the Lorraine region, which is the focus of this study. The technology of stone turning have been being introduced. What kind of productions have been turned? They include all the different sections of columns, be it the base, shaft, drums, capitals, sometimes also monolithic columns, as well as tables, their supporting foot, or even cooking vessels and cinerary urns. Other currently unknown types of items may also have been produced on the lathe. All sorts of stones have also been turned, from tender soapstones and limestones to very abrasive sandstones, or unexpectedly, hard stones such as granite. These are but a few examples from the Lorraine area of northeastern France, be it in sandstone and limestone. From the artifacts themselves, many questions arise. First of all, was stone turning actually a thing in the Roman period? Could it be much more frequent than expected? What does this technology look like, especially how does the lathe work? Which stones were turned in Lorraine? Which tools were used and for which materials? Can we find standardized products in the archaeological data? And how was it achieved? If we can find hints of the latter, does it mean there are specialized workshops? Were the craftsmen employed in quarries or on construction sites? Which limits were faced by the worksmen? What's the maximum weight that can be turned? And were there technical and economic thresholds for this technology to start being employed and to disappear? To try and answer these numerous questions, the methodology is twofold. Firstly, the archaeological inventory has just started, with more than 70 artifacts present in the collections of just one museum, le Musée de la Cour d'Or. If we can add all the different collections and museums of Lorraine, this hints at a very widespread phenomenon, both from sandstone and limestone extracted from all different parts of the region. No other conclusions can currently be drawn from this sprouting inquiry, but the experimental aspects of this study already gives more data. Indeed, in June 2022, the Fabri Tignvarii Association experimented stone turning. The first issue was the lathe. There are no historical sources at all that give any detail into the machine or even its name. Therefore, we could only rely on the archaeological data itself. Other experiments carried out by Jacques Gaillard, Guillaume Chaplin, and Thomas Flügen also helped us build our model. This lathe was entirely built out of wood by Johan Williams, woodworker and member of the Fabri Tignvarii. The basic design of this vertical lathe includes a heavy base with notches in the side where oaken wedges are inserted. The latter receives the oaken frame, which is reinforced by cross pieces. Some of the frame beams are positioned so as to allow different workers to introduce their chisel from large vertical slits or from the truncated horizontal posts. The center of the heavy base is cut with a circular opening, in which an ashwood disc is inserted. This piece in turn supports the entire weight of the column drum. It is also pierced by a smaller circular hole, receiving the boxwood axis, whose bottom part is circular and whose upper part is a square of 5.5 cm on each side, which is in the range of the mortises measured on the archaeological artefacts. The limestone block's mortise is then put onto the axis. A second, longer boxwood axis is inserted into the upper mortise of the block. Two heavy oak beams are then assembled and crossed on top of the frame through the axis by means of a circular hole. The upper end of the axis now receives a wide winch whose four arms are fixed with wooden pegs. Then we are ready to turn, although not quite ready, as I still have to explain what transformations the limestone blocks need to undergo first. The column drums start with 30 cm wide parallelepipedic semi-firm limestone blocks, freshly extracted from the Tenac quarries in Saintonge, southwestern France. The exact diameters of the drum are then drawn. The mortise is precisely cut into the etching using a flat chisel. The stoneworker then chooses his preferred means of action, the aim being to get as close to the final diameter as possible. The polygonal approach can be chosen, called epaneling. The four sides of the square stone face are cut into an octagon by means of mason hammers and chisels. In the same way, this octagon can then be divided into an hexadecagon, whose 16 sides are close enough to the circle for the lathe to work properly. Alternatively, a coarser method can be employed, using different hammers and chisels with notched blades. Nicknamed barley grain, the stoneworker can attempt to achieve a very coarse and rugged pseudo-circular drum. The polygonal drums take around 4 hours to be obtained, while the coarser drums are achieved in half this time. Now we can turn. The stone turners get into place with their very long and thick chisels. While only one pusher is necessary, the stone being quite light and the winch arms multiplying the worker's strength manifold, he does not need to work fast or run at all, as the turning process is an abrasive process, not a cutting action. Then the stone turner just needs to put his chisel into contact with the block for the abrasion to start. The way the blocks were prepared dramatically impacts the speed and quality of the turning process. Surprisingly, the coarser the grain, the better the process goes. Indeed, polygonal blocks have protruding edges that push on the chisel when turning. It's due to the lever effect. Worse, these edges sometimes break away, leaving very dented blocks. Oppositely, the small grains of coarsely prepared blocks give no resistance at all to the chisel and are chopped off cleanly and steadily. Up to half a centimeter of stone could be removed in only one turn of the winch. Thus, it took less than 1 hour to turn one complete drum of polygonal shape and half an hour only for the coarse-grained urns. It should be put in perspective with the many hours or even days which would be necessary with stone-cutting techniques. The resulting blocks, if relatively circular, include many grooves and ridges where the chisel goes too deep or too far away from the drum. They can still be refined a bit through oblique abrasion, as you can see, which removes the excess ridges but cannot help fill the grooves. We have yet to try polishing methods such as abrasion with different stones for even finer end products. The end result is a set of four drums for a very slender column, obtained in about 12 hours with three workers. Even faster rates of production should have been obtained by ancient stone turners. Now, comparing traces left on the experimental column and its archaeological counterpart, we can see clear analogies. Both display characteristic grooves, if larger in our case, maybe because of the flat chisel we used. Moreover, although their diameter is largely circular, the shape of the shaft itself is not perfectly cylindrical in both examples. The mortise is also similar. It displays trimmed off edges, which we discovered both allowed the axis to be inserted with force and was also chiseled in order to retrieve the boxwood axis after turning. This also prevents large pieces of the drum from being broken away when the axis hits a sharp angle, which happened to this experimental drum. At first glance, then, everything seems to match. But there is a but. In September 2022, barely 3 months after this first event, we brought the lathe on another reenactment weekend. This time, nothing worked as we intended to. The lathe was stored in a relatively wet place during this time, so its wood had slightly bent and dilated. So we had to reshape the ends of the arms of the winch. Some of the cross pieces had gotten out of their mortise, and the pegs did not stay in place. While turning our second drum, one of the wedges keeping the arms in place even broke off. Furthermore, the frame itself was now bending each time the chisel hit the stone. This lever effect created many vertical vibrations on the drums, which are completely absent in the archaeological data, and our drums kept a relatively polygonal shape also. Thus, there is definitely something wrong with our lathe, and that should be a good thing. It is certain that our model of the lathe is not as robust and stable as should have been for multiple working days to be carried out. Small wooden pegs and other refined assembly should be removed from the lathe, replaced by ropes or other sturdier joints. The winch should also be reworked, as a piece of robust timber would have sufficed for turning stone. Finally, the chisel must be kept in place so that the shape of the drum would be more regular. After our first two experiments, it's already clear that stone turning was an extremely worthwhile technology. Many days of work were saved and truly circular shapes could be achieved relatively easily. If the process demonstrated through our experiments works well, the lathe itself does not fare that well. A complete remodeling needs to be carried out for further experiments. The moldings have yet to be experimented, as well as better and more precise tools, especially for working sandstone. Therefore, it is still difficult to give any hint of standardization at this stage of the experiment and the inventory. It's equally premature to say anything about the technical and economic limits of stone turning, or the conditions for its genesis and its disappearance. To summarize, the advantages of stone turning are undeniable and already seem visible in the archaeological record. Much more work will be carried out in the following years, which I hope will bring more hints of the importance and frequency of this technology. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you will have many questions later.